So first speaker, history and the future direction of non-contrast enhanced MRA of peripheral arteries. Dr. Katsumi Nakamura from Tobata Kyoritsu Hospital in Japan. Please start.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I'm going to talk about history and the future direction of non-contrast enhanced MRA of peripheral artery. First, what is the motivation for development of non-contrast MRA? Safe alternative in patients with poor renal function, or reduces cost, or provides localizer or fallback of contrast enhanced MRA. Well, what is required for vascular imaging of peripheral artery? In task two classification, the severity of peripheral arterial disease is determined by location and degree and the extent of the stenosis, which is used as an indicator for patient treatment strategies. Can we get this information from non-contrast MRA? There are two non-contrast MRA techniques widely used. First, QIS. QIS utilizes an inflow effect of blood. Saturation of venous inflow and imaging slices are applied, and a weighted quiescent interval followed by FATSAT and balanced SSFP readout. Oops. As shown on the right, 9 segmentations were acquired in axial slices like time of flight and reformatted in coronal orientation. The advantages of QIS MRA are simple, robust, and fast. No scout required. Imaging parameters are fixed and resistant to patient motion. Scan time is about 7 to 8 minutes. A clinical case of QIS and contrast enhanced MRA with distal aorta and bilateral superficial femoral artery, SFA occlusions. Many collateral arteries are well depicted by QIS. QIS is also less affected by patient's leg motion. Slide shows a case with left hip arthroplasty. Flash readout can be used in QIS, which shows less susceptibility artifact. Let's move on to another non-contrast MRA technique, fresh blood imaging, FBI. FBI is first reported in 2000. However, 2D version of contrast subtraction angiography is published by Dr. Edelman's group in 1985. In FBI, after acquiring diastolic and systolic ECG triggered 3D data, the systolic diastolic subtraction followed by MIP processing. Then we can get arterial image. However, the early FBI had some problems. Longer examination time, inadequate visualization of small arteries, and some artifact. Slides show the changes of examination time of FBI. Initially, it took about an hour. And using parallel imaging, it took 40 minutes. Atlas speeder coil eliminates coil replacement, which is 27 minutes. And using direct tracker, it's about 21 minutes. Good. Now let's look at the image quality from left to right. original FBI of 0.5T and flow spoiler FBI, FBI using parallel imaging with Atlas Speeder coil and with delay tracker. In this way, it's clear that the image quality has reached sufficient level at the time using parallel imaging. I'm going to talk about key technologies in scan time reduction and improvement of depiction of peripheral arteries. First, flow spoiler FBI. This radiology paper explained how to utilize flow dephasing gradient pulses. Systolic artery can be suppressed with the help of flow dephasing pulses. Then overall contrast of artery will be increased after subtraction of systole and diastole. Slide show in a comparison of flow spoiled FBI using parallel imaging in comparison with CT angiography performed by 16 detector raw CT. The depiction of occlusion of bilateral SFA and superficial femoral arteries and many collateral arteries are comparable. Parallel imaging allows a shorter acquisition window that permits reduction of number of shots. Delay tracker calculates systolic and diastolic trigger delays from the patient's heart rate, which reduces preparation of scan like ECG prep, multi-phase single slice scan. Diagnostic ability of flow spoiled FBI at 1.5T are shown on the slide. The total sensitivity, specificity, and accuracy for detection of hemodynamically significant stenosis are more than 95%. Let's move on, 3T FBI. Higher SNR at 3T improved peripheral arterial depiction. I'm going to show you about some clinical cases of 3T FBI compared with angiography. 84 years old female with intermittent claudication. 3T FBI clearly depicts occlusion of bilateral SFAs, which is comparable with angiography. Case two, 55 years old male. 3T FBI and angiography depict left SFA occlusions and multiple small collateral arteries, and there's almost no difference. Bilateral BK region below the knee region are also depicted well by both methods. Case three, 75 years old female. 3T FBI shows an occlusion right SFA with collaterals, which appearance is almost same as that in angiography. Diagnostic ability of 3T FBI compared to angiography are shown on the slide. The overall diagnostic ability of 3T FBI shows very excellent. In the BK region, arterial visualization was excellent due to the high signal intensity at 3T. So 3T FBI further improved vessel visualization. However, acquisition time is extended due to prolonged T1 relaxation time. So new technique, centric KYKZ FBI, has been developed to further reduce acquisition time. Standard FBI took about 3 minutes, and centric FBI about 1/2 scan time of the standard. In addition, N-half artifacts are reduced in centric FBI, and motion artifacts also diminished in centric FBI. When KYKZ FBI used in clinical practice, it's expected to further reduce examination time. Now let's talk about calcification. The arterial wall calcification are frequently seen in peripheral arterial disease. Are calcification advantages or disadvantages to non-contrast MRA? Slide shows a 59 years old male with type 2 diabetes. In the CTA, it's difficult to evaluate arterial enhancement due to severe arterial wall calcification. FBI demonstrates occlusion of bilateral SFAs with many collateral arteries, which are not fully evaluated by CTA. In the left region, arteries seem to be depicted well in CTA. However, they are not arterial enhancement, but diffuse wall calcification. FBI presents right condition of arteries, which are reflected in decreased blood flow. Chris is also not affected by arterial wall calcification. Here, we see task two again. In type C region in L2-iliac and type B and C region femoral popliteal, there's a description of heavily calcified occlusion. Heavily calcified occlusion and heavy calcification. That means the evaluation of calcification is important for treatment strategy of patients. Recently, many techniques have been reported to evaluate calcification by MRI. In this slide, vascular calcium imaging using proton density weighted in-phase Stack-Opstaz flash is well correlated with CTA regarding contrast MRA is MR perfusion of toes because the evaluation of blood flow of foot has become more important due to increasing type 2 diabetes. Recent research from Dr. Miyazaki shows improved perfusion signals in distal foot. From tag off, from left, tag off, tag on, subtracted, signal increase ratio, SIR. The tag 4 pulses show the higher blood signal in the distal end in the subtractant and SIR images. One tag versus four tag. Increased perfusion signal with four tag pulses is clearly depicted. An example of perfusion calculation and ROI segmentation. perfusion curve shown on the right, and the four pulse shows increased signal in the distal feet and toes as compared to one tug pulse. In today's my presentation, non-contrast MRA shows that evaluation of stenosis is adequate and compatible to CTA and DSA. Evaluation of calcification could be possible, and perfusion can be additionally evaluated in the foot. So, is non-contrast MRA widely used in clinical practice? Unfortunately not. CT angiography is likely the first choice, at least in Japan. Probably many factors are involved. However, I'm sure they can be solved by all of you together here today. I believe if we can combine everyone's wisdom, we will be able to overcome any difficulties. Thank you.